We've been studying from God's word on the importance of emotional purity, right? And so this month, as we were looking at handling our emotions and managing our feelings and, you know, how we feel about things, not just how we think about things. So as we come to the last Sunday of the month, I was thinking of the importance. It's the messages that we have on Sundays are mostly prophetic, as in it's something that we pray, wait on the Lord, and the Lord gives in our hearts, like, okay, this is what I want you to say. So that's how we pick up the message and, you know, speak on that or study from the Bible and then share on that. So today, I felt in my heart strongly that we need to learn on the importance of leading ourselves. You know, we all like to lead others. Hello. Yes. Parents who tell children don't play on the mobile often use more mobile than children. Right? A lot of times these kind of things happen. Parents who tell children drive safely. You know, sometimes the parents are so careless while driving, absent-minded, thinking about other things. We all like to lead others. Many of us even know what the Prime Minister should do. But we sometimes are so careless about leading ourselves. But God says we are called to lead, and it begins with leading ourselves. And as I was thinking and praying about it, I felt in my heart I should invite Pastor Cynthia to come and speak on that. So give her a warm welcome as Pastor Cynthia comes up to speak.
Wow, it's an amazing time to be in the presence of the Lord. Thank you so much, Pastor. I've been praying, God, please take away this cup from me. But somehow the cup was not taken. That's why I'm here today. But every time when I stand here, I count it as a privilege and honor. And I believe that God will speak to us today. Amen? Amen. So this month, the first week, we learned about Christ being our refuge. We learned that how can we find our refuge in Christ. And then the last 2 weeks, we learned about emotional purity. How do we manage our emotions? And as Pastor said right now, we are going to look at how can we lead ourselves in Christ. In other words, the love that we have for God leads us to faithfulness, and that faithfulness produces fruitfulness in us, and then both faithfulness and fruitfulness brings wholesomeness into our lives. So to lead ourselves in Christ, we need to have a wholesome life. So we are going to look into that. How can we lead ourselves in Christ? Let me just tell you that those who are seated here, those who are seated outside, I want you to know that you are a leader. You know, there are God-given leadership skills in you. There are God-given leadership abilities in you. In other words, there is a hidden leader in each one of us. When we look at our world, we see that very few people realize that, and they respond to that call, and they make a huge difference in their lives. Because there is a wide range of misconception that lies in the world that not all are called to be leaders. Somehow this concept lies in the world that leaders are some privileged people, they are some special people, which is a wrong misconception. And according to the Greek philosophers like Socrates, Aristotle, they all decided in their generation to study, to discover on the dynamics of leadership. And they concluded their discovery by saying that if you got to be a leader, then you got to be born with it. You got to have leadership skills and abilities in you. If you have that, then you are a leader. And if you don't have that, you can't be a leader. And unfortunately, when you look around our world, we see that somehow people have believed this wrong misconception. When they look at themselves, they feel that they can't be a leader. They can't lead themselves. You know, let me just explain to you who is a leader. What makes a person a leader? Leaders are just ordinary people. They're just normal people What they do is that probably they would have been in some extraordinary circumstances where their potentials are revealed, their characters are produced, and that inspires people to put their trust, to put their hope in them. That's what a leader is all about. And according to these Greek philosophers, you see that these people who are put in extraordinary situations, they are not accepted as leadership materials. But yet, when you look throughout the history, you see that there were many men and women who came out as outstanding leaders in their generations. So I want to just show you one or two Bible characters. Look at the life of Moses. Moses was a fugitive. He ran away from Pharaoh's justice. He was a murderer. When we looked at his life, you see that he had no chance to be a leader. But later on, he became one of the most powerful leaders in the history. Look at the life of David. David was an insignificant person. Nobody valued him in his family. But when God's call came on his life, when he responded to that call, he became one of the most powerful kings in the history of Israel. Now, let's look at some world leaders. Look at the life of Abraham Lincoln. You see that he came from a very poor home. He had a very little formal education. But his faith in God, his trust in God, he became a national leader. And then later on, he became one of the most powerful, godly presidents of the United States of America. Look at Mother Teresa. She was an obscure, insignificant nun and a teacher. But her determination, her vision, her passion to serve the poor and the needy brought her all the way from Macedonia to Calcutta. And she served her purpose there. And she inspired millions of people. And she became one of the most powerful international leaders in our history. What am I trying to say here is this. Everyone can lead. We are born to lead. We are called to lead. We are created to lead. And this misconception that is buried in us, that we cannot be a leader, we are going to replace it by the Word of God. The Word of God says, when you know the truth shall set you free. Amen. Hallelujah. If there is anyone who can stop you from becoming from what God intends you to become, it is you. I'll say that again. If there is anyone who can stop you from what God has intends you to become, it's not the people, it's not the devil, but it is you. Be all you can be in Christ Jesus, because that's the heart of your Heavenly Father for each one of us. When you know that who you are in Christ, when you know how you are connected with God, when you know that Jesus is your source, and he is not only your source, but he is the source of power, glory, and honor. When you understand that deeply, along with Apostle Paul, you can say that I can do all things through Christ, through the one who strengthens me. Hallelujah. Amen. I would like to share a story here. There was a mouse and an elephant. They were very good friends. They were best friends. And as they were walking through the jungle, they had to cross over this huge bridge that was just right above a gorge. Gorge means it's a narrow valley that is between hills or mountains. So these both, as they were on the bridge, as they were walking, the bridge began to shake. Somehow they managed to cross over. And when they went to the other side, the little mouse, he looks at his huge companion elephant and he says, "Boy, we shook the bridge, didn't we?" Slowly you're understanding. You know what? Many times we are like that little mouse. We are small, we might be weak, we might be wimpy, we might be insignificant, but we have the strength of an elephant. You know, 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, the Bible says that the one who lives in us is greater than the one who is in the world. When you walk over the troubled waters of your life, when you walk over different challenges, different circumstances, remember that you are not walking alone. You have God Almighty by your side, walking along with you. And at the end of the journey, you can look at God and you can say, God, we shook the bridge, didn't we? Hallelujah. So now we are going to look at how did this misconception get into the world? Because when God created Adam and Eve, when God created man, he never created any hierarchy. There was no leader, follower, servant, nothing of that sort. But how did it end up there? For that, we need to go into the creation. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, the Bible says that God made man in his image, in his likeness. You know, I have read this passage many times, but when I was studying about this topic, that is when I realized that how much this verse signifies in our lives. When you read that deeply, you know God's purpose about you in that verse. Can you ever imagine God Almighty, the ruler of this universe, an infinite God, a God who is same yesterday, today, and forever? A God who cannot be limited in time, space, and matter. We were created in his image. We were created in his likeness. And then the Bible says that God breathed his breath. God breathed into man's nostrils. He imparted his spirit, his nature into man. Why did he do that? God wanted man to exercise his spiritual leadership and authority over the earth. And number three, God blessed Adam and Eve and said, you rule over the earth, have dominion over the earth, exercise your rulership and multiply. You see that God created man and woman to dominate the earth, to exercise, to govern the earth. God never created them to be dominated by the earth, but he created them to rule over the earth. He never created them to dominate each other, but he created them equal so that both of them can exercise his divine rulership over the earth. But then we all know what happened. Man rebelled against God, sinned against God, fell into sin, disobeyed God. And what happened when they disobeyed God, sin got into them, and God's spirit that was imparted into them, left them. In Adam and Eve, it was God's spirit dwelling in them, and now the glory, his spirit, left them. You know, throughout the Bible, when you read, you see that our God is a holy God. He cannot tolerate sin. He cannot compromise sin. And as generations went by, you see that, you know, there were people like Noah, Abraham, all of them came. God tried to interact with them. God tried to, mingle with people. But somehow, the damage of sin was already done on the face of the earth. And because of the consequence of Adam and Eve's sin, what happened? This unnatural leadership took place. A leader and a follower, a master and mastered, a ruler and ruled came into existence. So, however, when human race, when they interrupted God's plan, God always looked forward to restore, you know, human race back to God. He always looked for an opportunity. He always looked for people who were loyal to him in every generation. And at last, God Almighty found a way. He decided to send his own son. John 3:16. Can we read that together? The Bible says that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but will have everlasting life. To restore you and me back to God, Jesus had to pay a price. Jesus gave his life for each one of us so that we can be restored back to God to exercise our leadership and authority in our daily lives. So when you are born again in Christ, when you are in Christ, you are called to exercise his authority, his leadership in our daily lives. So quickly, we are going to look at how do we exercise our leadership in our daily lives. You know, when we look at our lives, we all have our domain of influence. We all have our sphere of influence. I'll tell you an example. My home is my area of influence. Anything that happens in my home, I make sure that I'm aware of it. I like to see things in order. I hold myself responsible over everything that happens in our home. Of course, pastor is the head of the house, but I hold myself responsible over my home because that's my responsibility. When it comes to church, I don't make decisions in the church because God has placed pastor there and God has given him a vision, a strategy to take the church forward. And also God has put right people around us to function so that each departments of the church, each departments of the church are functioned well. So we all have our sphere of life. You know, brothers and sisters, your leadership is something that starts from your home. Take leadership over your family. Young people, exercise your leadership among your friends. Don't allow friends to influence you. You should influence them. You might be a teacher, you might be a doctor, you might be a businessman or a woman, you might be a clerk, you might be a politician, you might be a homemaker. Whoever you are, wherever you are called to exercise his leadership and his authority in your sphere of influence. Amen? Are you all listening, church? So, now we are going to look at what is the first step to leadership. The first step of leadership is to discover ourselves. Who am I? Why am I here? When you're able to answer these questions sincerely, you will be able to find God's purpose for your life. You know, when you talk about discovering yourself, I have a very funny story to say. How I discovered myself, I'm going to share it here. You know, when I decided to serve God, when I decided to step into the ministry, those days, maybe 7-8 years back, I think, those days, our pastor, he often used to preach, use your time, your talent, your treasures in the kingdom of God. I used to hear this over and over and over again. So one day I thought, okay, maybe I shouldn't be just a person who just hear the word, but I should be a person who practices God's word. So I thought, okay, let me do some discovery on myself. So I decided, I took a paper and I began to write down on what am I good at? What are the things of my life which I can be used in the church? So there were a couple of points that I wrote down. But out of that, 3 points stood out for me. Number one was prayer. You know, I love praying to God. It's not that I always sit in one place and pray. No, I don't do that. But when I do my chores, I have a habit of praying. That is something that I love to do. That comes out of me effortlessly. And when I pray, I know that my God hears me. I'm confident about my prayer. Whether God answers me or not, it doesn't matter. But I know that I'm heard. I have that confidence in God. And not only that, I would love to pray for people. Whoever comes to me, I would just sincerely pray for them. So I found out that I was good in prayer. And then number two, I found out that I had an ability to listen to people. When people come to me with their need, their problem, I would just listen to them. And before I could pray with them, or before I could give them a piece of advice, they would tell me that we feel relieved after talking to you. And before I could pray, they are ready to leave. So I realized that I had the ability to listen to people. And number three, I found out that I could sing. At least that's what I thought. So I decided to work on these three aspects. So when you talk about prayer, those days, few years back in our church, while the service was going on, we had this few brothers and sisters lined up in the front, and they would just pray for people. That was called mid-prayer. So while the worship goes on, people who wanted prayer, they just come forward and get prayed. And I was a part of that, and I just enjoyed doing it because that was something that I loved to do. And then I decided to work on my singing part. I went and spoke to Pastor Justin, And then, of course, he said yes. And then there was something called worship Bible study. I was a part of that. And to cut the story short, I was in the choir singing for the Lord. I was so excited. Whenever I used to see women leading worship, you know, I would get very excited. That would excite me. So I would think, okay, if these women could lead worship, why can't even I also lead worship? So I decided to pursue on that. I spoke with Pastor. I spoke with some of our church sisters. So what happened was that we formed a team. It was called the women's team. It was called the women's band. In this band, all of them were women, musicians, singers, all of them were women. And I was so excited because I felt that I was pursuing God's purpose for my life. And as time went by, I realized that I was struggling here. I was not really enjoying it. Because when God gives you a purpose, when God puts His plans for your life, when there is His purpose in your life, He will also give you the grace. He will also give you the peace to go through it. And I didn't have grace, I didn't have peace, and I was struggling here. And I didn't want to drag others into it, so I thought maybe I must put an end to it. So in that process, I was pretty hurt. In that process, Pastor had to go to another city for preaching. And because it was a summer vacation, Pastor asked me, why don't you also come? So we all went together, all the four, we went together to this particular city for preaching. So Pastor was scheduled to preach in the evening, and we reached there towards the evening, and then straight away he went to preach. So after the preaching was over, this pastor who invited us took us to his home for dinner. So while we were having dinner, this pastor, he just stares at me. He looks at me and he says, "Sister, tomorrow you have to preach." And I was like surprised, shocked. I had already food in my mouth. And I didn't know what to say. Anyway, I managed to put a beautiful smile on my face and I said, "Pastor, I'm sorry, I don't preach." He repeated the whole thing again. "You have to preach tomorrow." It was more like a command to me. And I was disappointed. And I told him very politely that I don't preach. The more I said no, the more he insisted me on preaching. And our pastor, he never got into this. He was just enjoying and having fun. So I decided to keep quiet because I realized that my no was not working. So I thought, okay, let me just keep quiet. So in my heart, I was thinking, you know, our pastor, he doesn't force me for anything. He doesn't force me. He's such a well-behaved pastor. So I was thinking, if our pastor can be such a well-behaved person, why can't this pastor also be like him? But anyway, I didn't tell him. I came back to the room. Pastor and children, they slept. That night, I couldn't sleep. I was unable to sleep. Already my mind was disturbed. And on top of that, this pastor wanted me to preach. And I don't even know this pastor. I know him as pastor's friend. We haven't interacted, nothing more. So I began to pray. I began to ask God, "God, what do I do? I don't want to preach. I don't like preaching. What do I do?" The more I prayed, I felt in my heart that soft voice telling me, "You preach, you can do it." And I was like, "God, this is not fair. This is not fair." The more I prayed, again I felt in my heart that "You preach, you can do it." So what I did, with so much hesitance, I pulled out my Bible, I took out a paper, and I began to pray and ask God, "God, help me to preach." I have never stood before people, an audience. I have never stood on a stage, never. And I didn't know how I was going to do it. The next day morning, we went to the church, we finished the praise and worship, and this pastor, he calls me out from the stage by saying, "Now Sister Cynthia is going to come forward and deliver God's word." So I went on the stage, I just got up and went. I actually thought that maybe I might faint. Or maybe, you know, you know, while I'm going on the stage, or maybe I'm on the stage, I might faint. That's what I thought. But when I stood on the stage, I realized that I didn't faint. I was fine. And I felt God's strength around me, and I began to speak. And also, I had a translator with me, which was a great comfort for me, because when he took time to translate, I had some time to think on what to say next. So this went on. So while I was preaching, I saw our pastor and this pastor, they were in a very serious discussion. They were talking something very serious. And I began to wonder, what is this? Because it was distracting me. And I didn't want to look at that side because I didn't want to forget my message. So I focused, I managed to look at the crowd, and I preached. I finished my preaching, I came and I sat down. When I came and sat down, this pastor goes onto the stage and says, what a blessed message we heard and all those things. And then our pastor, he told me the conversation that they had between each other. So this pastor asked our pastor, how often do you allow your wife to preach in the church? So our pastor replied saying, Pastor, this is the first time I'm seeing my wife preach. And this pastor couldn't believe. He thought our pastor was joking. So he asked him again, Pastor, I'm seriously asking you, how often do you allow your wife to preach in the church? And pastor replied by saying, this is the first time I'm seeing my wife preach. And that was the conversation that they were having while I was preaching. You know what, church? The Bible says that God's strength is made perfect in our weaknesses. Hallelujah. You show your weakness to God, and my God is able to perfect it with His strength. All this while, I was trying to pursue myself. You know, in that process, I was trying to become like someone. I wanted to be, you know, like some other women worship leader. And I realized that, you know, I was losing my track. And this is something that started from the Garden of Eden. When you look at Adam and Eve, their problem was that they wanted to become like God. That is why they fell into sin, they disobeyed God. The truth was that they were already in the likeness of God. And in another passage, you see that the children of Israel, they wanted to be like other nation. They demanded a king. And God told Prophet Samuel that they have not rejected you as their leader. They have rejected me as their king because they want to become like other nation. You know, to become like somebody is something that runs in our human blood. That is why Ephesians chapter 5 verse 1, the Bible says that, you know, therefore be imitators of God, dear children. Let me tell you something, church. There is no greater calling, there is no greater purpose than imitating your Lord, than imitating your Creator. Hallelujah. Young people, let me tell you something. Don't you ever try to become like someone. You discover who you are, because there is so much of God-given inherent qualities and potentials invested in you. Don't you ever try to imitate. Don't ever try to become like someone. Discover yourself. Figure out who you are. Dare to be different. You know, if you got to pull out a paper, write down on the paper, what are you good at? Focus on your strengths. Focus, you know, when you write down on the paper, you make sure that you should write down your strengths, you should write down your weaknesses, and focus on your strengths. And ask God for His guidance. And wait on the Lord. Let God speak to you. You know, sometimes I've heard people saying that, you know, we have been waiting and waiting on the Lord, but God doesn't speak. That is so true. God doesn't speak when we want to hear Him. We will have to wait. But let me tell you something. Even if there is a delay, God is faithful to speak to you. When you wait on the Lord, when you're persistent, when you're consistent to know what's God's plan for your life, He is faithful to speak to you. Until then, you wait. And in the meantime, while you're waiting, you continue to do what you're doing. Because the Bible says that when you're faithful in the little, He will make you faithful over much. Hallelujah. Amen. So, okay, you can put your hands together and give a wonderful hand clap to the Lord. So when you discover yourself, you see that, The results of discovering yourself is that you become aware of who you are in Christ. There is a true identity that you have in Him, and that also gives you the strength to move forward into the purpose, into the plan that God has in store for you. So when you discover yourself, that is the key to capture your vision. So when you figure out your purpose for your life, there is a vision that comes to life. So let's look at what is a vision. Vision is something that is inspired by God. God put vision in us so that it can be a blessing in the life of others. Let me just give you a distinction between purpose and vision. Purpose is a realization of the reason you were born, and vision is a method, the process, the strategy you use to fulfill the purpose of which you were born. In other words, vision is like pregnancy. When a woman conceives, there is no guarantee that she is going to bring forth a healthy child. Sometimes there can be a miscarriage. In that similar way, when God put His vision within you, if it is not nurtured well, if it is not attended well, if it is not taken care well, it can be aborted. So in other words, God put the vision in us, and we work out the vision to the outside. A beautiful example from the life of Joseph, I want to show you. Joseph was a dreamer. You know, he never settled down for small things. He was a dreamer. And of course, God had amazing plans about Joseph. And in that zeal and in that excitement, he went and shared his dream with his brothers. You know what, church? Remember, your vision, your dreams, your potentials, your strengths, they are a target for the devil. And as long as you don't work on it, as long as you're not pursuing on this, devil is very happy. But when you start working on your vision, when you start working on your God-given strengths, He is going to bring all kinds of distractions on your way to slow you down from reaching the vision. And sometimes He will also give you ideas to go ahead of God's timetable. You see that from the life of Abraham. God told Abraham that I'm going to give you a promised son. He waited, waited, waited. He became so impatient, and he went ahead of God's timetable. And that is how Ishmael was born. So devil is not going to be excited when you are working towards your vision. And another thing we must remember is that don't share your vision with everyone. You know your vision. You have a full picture of what your vision is going to be, but others don't. They won't understand your vision. So look forward to share your vision, your aspirations with people who are on same page with you. That is what happened in the life of Joseph. He went and shared his vision, and he ended up in pit. And from there, he went to prison. So the devil tried all kinds of his tricks to beat him down from the outside, but he was getting stronger in his inside. He never allowed his vision to die. And when the right time came, God promoted him, and he became the second in command. He became the prime minister of Egypt. So God put a vision in Joseph. And you see that during the time of famine, when it went through the time of famine, it was Joseph's strategy, it was his idea, it was his plan that saved Egypt from the time of famine. So when God puts a vision within you, you work it out, and it becomes a blessing in the lives of people. So now we are going to look at how do we discipline ourselves towards the vision. What does discipline mean? Discipline means imposing strict guidelines over your life. Never allow people to dictate your life. Never allow people to set the guidelines for your life. Your guidelines should be in accordance to the Word of God. To be an effective leader, you got to discipline yourself to be consistent, to be stable, to be calm. And if you don't discipline yourself in this area, you can be carried away by the circumstances that happens around you. A beautiful example that I want to show you from the Bible is the life of Moses, a negative example. You see that Moses was always away from people in the wilderness. And in Moses' absence, it was Aaron who was in charge of people. So one day the people comes to Aaron and says, we don't know where this Moses is. We need a God to lead us. You see that Aaron didn't even ask, or he didn't even advise the people, what foolish thing are you doing? Have you ever thought about that? Nothing. He just obliged to them and he just obeyed them and made that golden calf for them. You see that Aaron's leadership indicates a very poor leadership. He didn't have a voice, but it was people's voice, people's opinions. He was carried away by that. It was no longer Aaron leading people, but it was people leading Aaron. And such kind of people cannot be an effective leader. And another point that we must remember is this. To be an effective leader, your life should be dependent on these two words. It's either yes or no. Your life is dependent on these two words. You cannot be in a compromised situation. It's either compromise or faithfulness to your call. You know, sometimes we would ask our children, do you want to go for an ice cream? So they are a little hesitant. So what they say is this, we are even on this. So that means they do want, but you know, they're even. That kind of attitude, it will never work in our life. Let your yes be yes, let your no be no. Amen? So now quickly, now we are going to look at what are the priorities. How do we manage our priorities towards our vision? Managing your priorities is all about choosing what is important among many valuable alternatives. Apostle Paul, he said a very profound words. Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. And that is so true. Many things in our life, they are good, but we must determine what is best for us in the light of our calling. Our priority comes first with our relationship with God, knowing that God is the source of our blessings, that He is the initiator of our vision. Number two is our relationship with our family. Make sure that when God gives you a vision, make sure that your family is also along with you. Don't neglect your family. After the responsibility of God, the next responsibility is your family. So make sure that your family is along with you and they are able to understand your vision. Number three is our duties. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. The Bible says that whatever that you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men. In different vocations of our life, whatever that we do, do it in excellence. Don't do it for your boss, but do it as if that you are doing it unto the Lord. Amen? So when we are able to manage our priorities, that gives you the strength that will help you to reach your destination. Let me close with this. The greatest leadership role whom we can trust on, whom we can look upon, whom we can count on, the greatest leadership role that will never change is our Lord Jesus. Jesus never built a church. He never built a building. He never produced any products, but He created people. He raised leaders. He raised leaders who changed the course of history. And we are His children, and we are here to make a difference in our lifetime. So may our eyes be fixed on Jesus. The Bible says that looking unto Jesus, being the author and finisher of our faith, let's run our race well. Amen? We are going to look to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to your presence this day. We thank you, Lord, that you have called us to lead. We thank you, Lord, that you have amazing plans about each one of our lives. We thank you, Father God, for your divine purposes. For us is always right. Continue to lead us in your truth and in your love. Bless the rest of the service for us, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's put our hands together. Give a warm welcome to our pastor.
Thank you, Pastor Cynthia, for that beautiful message. Give her a big God bless you, will you, church? Everyone here, God has called us to be great leaders. Amen. That place she first preached was in Raichur. Men, I'll tell you one thing. Once you are married, when your wife is talking, keep quiet. this one principle will give you a lot of blessings in life. Thank you for that beautiful message. It was a beautiful blessing. Shall we stand and we will sing a song? And those who want to give to God, this is your time to give as they pass the bags, your tithes, your offerings. And we'll sing this beautiful song, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care. Today in the prayer, I also want to take time to pray for those of you who may be struggling with identifying and developing your potential. I want to pray that the Holy Spirit will help you to look at what God has put inside you and it'll rise up for His glory. You know, you don't need a mic and a pulpit to shine for Jesus. In your place of work, in your neighborhood, in your college, you can impact lives. You can change situations. Sometimes not in other people, but in yourself. Lead yourself into the plan of God Almighty. And all we need is our shepherd to be with us. Let's sing that together. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care, my Jesus, in thy blessed pastures feed us, for I use thy folds prepare. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us like we are. Blessed brought us thine we are. We are thine, thou dost befriend us. Oh, be the God you know the way, my Jesus. Keep thy flock from sin, defend us. Seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, you're all hear us when Jesus, blessed Jesus, we will early turn to thee. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, we will early turn to thee. Let us, come on church, let's sing it together to Him. Oh, early, let us do thy will. Blessed Lord and only Savior, with thy love our bosoms fill. Blessed Jesus, thou hast loved us, loved us still. Blessed Jesus. said, Jesus, thou hast loved us. Every eye's closed. Let's pray for a few minutes and say, God, in the calling that you have given to me, I want to discover the things you put in my heart over a period of time, for the age, for the time that you have given to me. I want to discover your talent. I want to discover the things you put in my life, and I want to grow on it. In the mighty name of Jesus, every fear, every confusion, every disturbance, every power of the enemy that comes in the way to disturb the call of God this morning, we rebuke it by the blood of Jesus. Let people rise up into the call of God. Let people walk in the abundance in Jesus' name. Deliverance by the blood of Jesus. Ancestral curses. Curses and witchcrafts and works of the enemy be broken in the mighty name of Jesus. Oppressive spirits that are disturbing people from coming into the fullness of God Almighty. In the mighty name of Jesus, this morning, Lord, we want to thank you for the deliverance that comes by your word. This morning, what you have spoken to us, let it be fulfilled in every life in the name of Jesus. As homemakers, as people in their colleges, as scientists or engineers, as politicians or in the judiciary or in the journalists, wherever they are, let them rise up for your glory in the mighty name of Jesus. Every pressure that pulls them down this morning, we rebuke it in the name of Jesus. Go ahead, worship him this morning for some time. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, express your faith in God. Express your praise. Express your thanks to Jesus. When you walk in the will of God, when you walk in the plan of God, every bondage is burning out in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 This morning, we declare the deliverance by the blood of Jesus. Let people rise up into the plan of God, into the call of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lift your hands to him and tell him, Lord, you are my shepherd. You are the shepherd of my soul, and I give you full control. Wherever you lead me, Lord, I will follow. Come on, lift your hands and tell him, I want you beside me. I don't want any success in life if you are not there with me, Lord. I want you to be with me, Father. And every success, every victory, I want to celebrate it with you in my life, Jesus. Hallelujah. Maybe you want to put your hands down, but let's sing it together as we worship him. Oh, shepherd of my soul, I give you full control. Wherever you may be, I will follow. I have made a choice to listen to your voice. Wherever you I will. Shall we sing it one more time? It's a prayer. You are the shepherd of
my soul.
I give you full control. Wherever you may lead, I will follow. I have made a choice to listen to your voice. Wherever you may lead, I will go. Be it in a quiet pasture or by a gentle stream, the shepherd of my soul will be my guide. soul will be mine. Let's sing it just one more time. You are the shepherd of my soul. I give you full control. Wherever you may be, I will follow. I have made a choice to listen to your voice. Wherever you may lead, I will go. Be it in a quiet, be it in a quiet pasture, or by a gentle stream, the shepherd of my soul will be my guide. Should I face a mighty mountain or a valley dark and deep, the shepherd of my soul will be my guide. This morning we want to thank you, Heavenly Father, because no mountain is too big that it cannot be moved when you are with us. No valley is too dark that it cannot be lit up when you are with us. We want to thank you that this morning you have spoken to our hearts, and we want to say yes to your word. We want to say yes, Lord, your will be done in our lives. Thank you that you're calling us to a higher level of who you want us to be. Thank you for that. Thank you that you trust us with your presence. Help us not to run behind public opinion, but to run behind your divine opinion. Help us not to be persuaded by what others appreciate or think, but help us to be persuaded by what you appreciate. Even if nobody sees what we are doing, even if nobody appreciates what we are doing, we want to be faithful in what we do in our offices, in our colleges, in our neighborhoods, because end of it all, we are doing it in our faithfulness to you, O Master, in our faithfulness to your call. Yes, Holy Spirit, may that anointing of yours rest upon each one of us, and especially this season. Lord, we pray for your children. As so many people around Bangalore are falling sick because of the weather and allergies, the dengue fever and so many problems, in the name of Jesus, we invoke the word of God. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. No plague shall come near your dwelling. In Jesus' mighty name, by the word of God, by the covenant of the blood of Jesus, by the living word of God, I declare the healing of God upon the people. Let your children walk in good health and good strength. May your divine protection and covering of the blanket of healing be upon your people. Father God, bless the offerings and tithes that your children are giving to you out of respect and honor for your word, in obedience to your scripture. May abundance be back in their lives as you've promised harvest to all who sow into your kingdom. Bless us. To you be all the glory and honor. We love you, Master. Thank you for you are with us. In Jesus' most holy and matchless name we pray. And the people said, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of our Heavenly Father, and the sweet abiding presence of the Holy Spirit rest and abide upon each and every one of us from now and forevermore. Amen. Love you. God bless you. Have a blessed weekend.
This program is made possible by your faithful financial support. Join us along with the thousands hearing God's word. If you are in Bangalore, please join us at Bethel AG Church International Worship Center, number 67 Ring Road, Hebbal, Bangalore 24. or visit us online at www.bethelag.in. Thank you for watching.